Hello and welcome to this fourth how-to session. Today I'll be walking you through how to construct dynamic simulations. It's actually pretty straightforward. We will definitely spend a lot of time looking at how to set up dynamic assumptions in our solution with confidence. But before we will do that, we will quickly review together why the dynamic assumption is a major focus in the context of IRRBB, and more broadly in any context of measuring risk and profitability. So again, the idea is just to give a quick picture, set the picture of why today we are talking about a dynamic simulation and not at all to deep dive into the regulatory requirements. I'm pretty sure that everybody who has dialed in is extremely familiar with those requirements. We just want to give some context, understand what is it that our customers have to achieve when implementing IRRBB. One of our concerns is indeed definitely to address the regulatory requirements and ensure that assumptions of a balance sheet can be defined to derive the 1-year NII, whether it's strictly by rolling maturing items or with maybe more sophisticated modeling to reflect business specificities and strategic decisions, which is actually something that we recommend that we aim for. But as you can see here in the statement by BCBS, it's also something that is hinted by them more and more. So it definitely says that more sophisticated dynamic modeling techniques that reflect potential future business activities is really something that that we should aim for ultimately, and not necessarily just limit to the renewal for 1-year NII. But let's look at that later in further details on how to either strictly address the rolling of maturing items or going a step further. So, again, why today we are covering dynamic assumptions in our solution, and we are looking at how the dynamic assumption in our solution can help in the implementation in IRRBB is because we understand that it's a major challenge for most of the banks we've been talking to. But we also wanted to take the opportunity to show you that the dynamic simulation could also be leveraged in the balance sheet management and optimization spaces, and that the implementation of IRRBB should not only be about necessarily just meeting some requirements, but could be a great opportunity to maybe review methodology, enhance internal risk and profitability management, and maybe align all together those different spaces with like consistent methodologies, assumptions, and view, which is definitely something that should be done in one single product, and we believe our solution is a good fit to be this product. So now that we have given a broad idea of why today we are talking about dynamic simulations, let's deep dive into our solution. Actually, right before going into the different features that we will be going through that are available in our solution, I thought it would be great to give you an idea of what type of reporting could be built leveraging scenario-focused simulation framework. So here, if you can see, I'm showing here a reporting. It's actually monthly NII over across a semester for different scenarios. So each color represents a scenario. And so each scenario has different assumptions. So there are two types of business projection assumptions. So in some cases, it's a flat balance sheet. And some other cases, it's a growing balance sheet. And then on top of it, we have combined those assumptions with a interest rate scenarios with up and down shifts. The idea I'm showing is really just one reporting among many that we could be doing. But the idea, again, is to show that our framework will give you the possibility not only to define some assumptions, but to define different sets of assumptions that can be run at once within one single process, so that later you can generate results for all the different assumptions and compare the results for all of them, so that it can help in making good decisions. I've been mentioning scenario a lot. Scenario is a major concept in RCO, and I think it's worth spending some time and having a look at the solution together. So I will switch from the slides to the solution to give you, if I can, I will share. So the scenario, the reporting that we are looking at is obviously, the reporting we are looking at is obviously, okay, sorry, I'm just doing that. Okay, it should take a minute, I think, for you to see my screen. So yeah, the idea is that I'm generating such a reporting by running a process. So the first thing I will show you is a process. I hope it's working and you can see I'm showing a process right now in our solution. So here I have defined one process. And as you can see, there are a few parameters, the reporting currency, the time segmentation that I'm going to use to generate and aggregate my results, but the company for which I'm running this process, but the most important one is the scenario set. And that's exactly what I want to show you. So what is a scenario set? I just have to click there to show you my scenario set. So my scenario set is called IRRBB scenario set. Unfortunately, we don't have the time today to go through all the different all the details that are available here in the solution, but I just wanted to give you, show you quickly a scenario, because I feel it's something that is coming, I'm going to talk about quite a lot. I think it's worth having a look. So this is my scenario set. It's called IRBB. What is a scenario set? It's a group of scenarios. Actually, here I have six scenarios under my scenario set. And ultimately, when I'm running my process, I'm going to generate results for each of those scenarios. There are many building blocks that can differ within each scenario. The most common one are maybe the market data, and the behavior modeling, but the one we will be focusing on today is the business projection space, where actually we can define different, there are multiple ways of defining assumptions, and the one we will be focusing on is called balance strategy, and then I will briefly introduce some others. So the idea is that here I have multiple scenarios. Each of those scenarios will have a very different balance strategy. The balance strategy is something that we will be deep diving into. So I'm not going to spend too much time in the solution. The idea was just to say, okay, we will be talking about the balance strategy and assumptions a lot. It's important to have an idea of how it fits into our framework. It's actually the balance strategy is one of the building blocks of the scenario, and the scenario are run as a whole according to how many scenarios you are mapping to a scenario set within your LM process. So that's the flow. But I'll stop sharing and I'll go back to my slides. So again, why did I show you the ALM process and the scenario is because ultimately the idea is to run an ALM process, to have some new volume deals generated during this process according to some assumption that we have defined. And once those deals are generated, what is expected and what is happening in our engine is that cash flows and analytics are generated, so that ultimately you can derive reporting, analytics, result, gap, anything that you're interested into, NII, just like I was showing in this this graph, and so that you can compare what's the impact of your assumptions on any analytic. So that's the idea. That was just a brief introduction, and now we can talk about the balance strategy. So I just mentioned it while I was showing you the scenario. It's actually a dedicated feature to define dynamic assumptions. It's a feature that will give you the possibility, for example, to project new lending amounts for loan accounts, or it will give you the possibility to project types of new deposits that will flow into the bank of a specific horizon that is defined. And again, during our LM process, all those assumptions are going to be used to generate deals. So here I'm showing you an example of a BSS to have a look. The BSS is actually a grid. In this grid, we have, let's say, three sections. The first section is the group of deals that you want to renew or not renew. So it's actually corresponding to one of the first setup that needs to be done in order to define assumptions. Altogether, there are three steps that are shown here and that are highlighted with different blue color. The other part of the grid is actually about determining the business volume, which is the second step. So, what are the targets? How many deals do I want to generate? We will see that there are different ways of defining those targets. And finally, the last step of the definition of the BSS is the characteristics of the new volume deals. The idea is, again, we are expecting the system to generate new volume deals. We not only need to define how many, but also what kind of deals there are. So we'll have a look. I'm not showing it because it's not part of this grid. It's another UI that we will look at later on. So let's start by focusing first on the targets or the business volume. So as I mentioned, there are multiple ways of defining those targets. There are first different target measures. It's highlighted in purple in the screen. You can see that I have defined different new volume targets for different group of deals. So for facility, for example, I'm defining a new business volume. For saving, I'm defining segment ending balance. And for loans, I'm defining an average balance here. That's what I did in my example. So what exactly does it mean? For all the balance targets, so the segment ending balance, the average balance, we also actually have the possibility to define a segment begin balance. So for all those balance targets, the system calculates the size of the new volume deals to achieve a targeted balance for the time segment. So for each time segment, our engine is going to compute the balance, and this balance is including the stock deals and the new volume deals that were generated for previous time buckets. And it's comparing it to the amount that is defined in each bucket. So that's how those different volume targets are working, how the new business volume is working. So the one that I have assigned to the facility is much more straightforward. It's actually this target actually represents the size of new volume deals to generate. So it's much straightforward. So only with the segment ending balance, average balance, are we taking into account actually the balances and runoff of existing stock deals and new volume deals. So that's the first option that you have. And then I mentioned a few times amount. Actually, we don't necessarily have to define target as amount. It's actually what I have done for the loans group that is highlighted in red in my slide. I've actually defined some target amounts. So I have different targets for each bucket. Something I didn't mention is that actually here the buckets are monthly, but actually it's pretty flexible. Like this time segmentation is user defined, so I could define target monthly, quarterly, yearly, or maybe daily is not necessarily recommended because it's a lot of granularity, but maybe monthly for a year and then quarterly or something like that. So anyway, it's like pretty flexible and can be defined by the user. And it's used in case we want to, it's used here, so I can define some target amount for each of those segments. But as you can see, for facility and saving, I didn't define any amount, but I defined the formula. I have selected formula in the blue column here where I have the target definition type. As long as I'm choosing the formula over the amount, I no longer have to define some amount by bucket, but I need to select and map a formula. We will look at the details of how those formula work and how what can be achieved and how useful they can be. It's actually a great tool. It's super flexible. It requires first that they are defined in the formula library that is available in RCO, that it can be selected here. So the amount can be very much useful because sometimes you just want to be able to import directly the assumptions from the FP&A team, for example. But using the formula, we will see that it can help, especially in the IRRBB context. Okay. Something that's to go back to the green part of where I mentioned that those were the group of deals that we want to renew. Actually, this is really a hierarchy of group of deals. It's user-defined. It can either be your chart of accounts, and actually we will see that the assumption can be very flexibly defined at different level of your chart of accounts. So it can be at the node, just like it can be at the account level. But it could be also a hierarchy that is different from your chart of accounts because you might want to flexibly define group of deals to map assumptions to maybe something like a floating mortgage, for example, and that is not necessarily matching the granularity of your chart of accounts. So that's really a choice that you have for further flexibility. So I mentioned quite a few times the formula, saying that it's super flexible and it's a great tool to define the targets. So just to focus a bit more on the formula grammar, it's actually composed of many elements. So here I have a few examples to show what type of grammar that is available. It's something that I will walk you through. I can understand that right now, just looking at it, it can feel like it's a lot. But the idea is that you can use many different types, like whether it's like referring to a balance, referring to at a specific date, at the reporting date, in the past, referring to some lookup tables. One thing that you can definitely do, I kept talking about how it's helpful for in the IRRBB context, you can really easily set a target amount to be constant to address the renewed balance sheet requirements. With the first example that I'm showing here, where it's showing ending balance seg equal reporting date balance, the idea what this equation means is actually that the targeted segment ending balance of each bucket has to be equal to the balance of reporting date. So it's basically a constant balance sheet. It also gives the possibility to define the target of a group of deals referring to target of balance of another, which actually can be extremely helpful and make sense in the context of balancing some accounts, so balancing some group of deals. I have defined a specific assumption for a group of deals. I'm not going to define any assumption for this other group of deals, I'm just going to assume that it's matching or it's aligned. It's making sense whenever I want to maybe balance some accounts or maybe apply some kind of pass-through rate or maybe derive target of for a subgroup of deals. Like actually it's shown in the example. So if I go back to my example where I have defined, if you look at the assets in my BSS, I have my grid and I have a line, a node of my chart of accounts is assets. For this node, I have defined some assumptions as some amount. But then, for the overdraft account, which is actually, the overdraft is part of the asset node, instead of defining some amount there, I define a formula, and in the formula, I'm saying that actually the target is one-fourth of the target amount of the assets. So I can easily define, instead of having to define some assumption or do on the side in Excel or somehow trying to explode the assumption for assets outside the system by defining some rules, those rules can be defined within our solution with the formula. So it's pretty useful. And the one last example use case I wanted to share with you is actually the use of the historical balances. You might want to define the growth of your balances according to historical observations. It can be nice, can be a way to smooth or to kind of, to either smooth the assumptions of growth of your balance sheet or make it more realistic, which is usually something that we are trying to achieve when it comes to NII projections. So in this case, we can refer to the historical balances through the formula. So that's my last example. It's the very last example where I can see that actually the ending balance is computed by looking at the balance in the past. So I'm looking at the balance in the previous month. That's what is shown, like tenor D0 month one. It means balance in the previous month. And it's looking also at the balance 3 months area. So we are doing some kind of average of the balance 3 months before the segment ending, the segment, and 1 month before. So that's how we can use the formula. We definitely see everybody's using the first formula for a flat scenario, and then people using a lot of different formulas for other scenarios. Again, using the formula to kind of distribute the assumptions that are defined by FP&A team, for example, at not such a granular level is something that we see people using a lot. Historical balances is also something that we see people using a lot, and that is nice. Okay. The last step of the setup of the BSS, if you remember in the first slide, there were 3 steps, and the last step is the simulated deal characteristics. So in this one, we are not looking at the grid anymore. The grid was mainly about how many deals do I need to generate, and here we have a whole dedicated UI template that gives you the possibility to do what are the characteristics of those deals that I'm going to generate. So this screen is called actually allocation set. It's a template of deal characteristics. So here I'm looking at highlighted in purple, showing that we are looking at the template for loan depot. But I would have template for each instrument type that is supported by new volume generation. So it includes loan depot, but also facilities, bonds, repo. Forex swap, I hope I'm not forgetting anything. So we would have different allocation sets for each of those instruments, because we need to make sure that all the characteristics that are required for cash flow generation are properly defined, or that the user is defining assumptions for each of those fields. So how the user can define assumptions? He actually has two options. The first option is what is done for the interest type, where we have selected user defined. Whenever I'm selecting the option user defined for one characteristic, it gives the possibility to the user to define an assumption, in the sense that it means that the user will be defining what the characteristic for all the deals that are being generated. So that's an option. And then the other option is to use the option from stock. This option from stock is actually about having our engine analyze the whole existing combinations of the stock deals and generate new deals with the same combinations and in the same proportions. So why I'm talking about proportion is combination, because most likely the option from stock is not used for only one of the characteristics, but for a few. And so we have to analyze every stock deals, actually every stock deal that has been originated within the analysis depth, which is highlighted in blue. The analysis depth is a way to filter, okay, what are the exact deals that I want to look at when it comes to analyzing and deriving characteristics. It might not make sense to look at the deals that were originated 2 years ago, because it might not be relevant. Whereas if I look at all the deals that were generated in maybe the last 2-3 months, it should give you a good idea of what are the characteristics of the deal that might be originated tomorrow. So those are the options. So it's either user has the possibility to define an assumption, so it's defining, somehow we could say it's hard coding the value of the characteristics or the deals that are going to be generated, or you have the possibility to leverage the engine using the option from stock to get those characteristics derived by the engine by looking at the characteristics of the stock deals. Actually, if you look at the green section, you would see that there are more options than just user defined and from stock. There is also the average value. There is also an option of from segmented stock. Average value and from segmented stock are strictly similar in the way they work as from stock. It's always about looking at the existing deals. It's just that we recommend them for numeric values, date or tenors, cases where you don't necessarily want to have deals generated for all the different combinations. I don't know, let's say that you would want to do from stock for the rate. Do I really want to have one deal generated with every single possible rate? Do I want to have all my new volume deals to be generated with one rate that is the average value of a specific group of deals? But ultimately, it's still the same idea. It's just that it would be a better fit for, again, numeric values, data, tenors, because of the number of the new volume deals that would be generated. That would be huge if we were to use from stock. So that's the deal characteristics. So I talked about most characteristics in general, where we have those two options. There is one characteristic that is always a challenge, is the rate value for fixed deals. Pricing of simulated deals can always be a challenge. So what we did, we have introduced some methodologies to derive the fixed rate of simulated deals. Those methods is what we are calling the rate determination method. This is what is in purple. The user has the possibility to choose among a few different methods. So the first method and the one that is selected here is the forward rate. So with the forward rate, we are basically generating a forward rate with the value date mm-hmm. being the value date of your the value date of each of your simulated deals. And the curve and the maturity of your rate will depend on the assumptions that are also defined in the allocation set, and they are here highlighted in green, is the pricing curve name and the pricing tenor. So here in this case, for each deal would be priced with a LIBOR USD 3-month forward rate, value date being each of their value dates. That's an option. There are two other options, actually. One is called strip. In this case, there isn't the necessity to define a pricing curve name or a pricing tenor. With the strip method, what we are doing, we're applying the strip formula that is supported in our FTP FTP module. If you are not familiar with the strip formula, it's quite similar to the computation of an effective interest rate, we could say. So that's the second rate determination method that is available. So it's deriving the pure interest rate using this strip formula. And then finally, the third option, which is again leveraging FTP formulas, is called the FTP method. This method is actually a great method. I personally like it a lot. I think it makes a lot of sense, but it requires for you to use also our FTP module. So how does it work? The idea is that if you are leveraging our CO, and that's for your FTP computation, it means that you have set up your FTP methodology in the system. Once the FTP methodology is set up in the system, it's used to compute FTP rate of all the deals, but it's also going to be used to derive the interest rate of all the new volume deals. So what is done in order to derive the fixed rate of new volume deals, we are just computing an FTP rate, an all-in FTP rate, using your own methodologies. And then I've talked about those three methods that are actually meant to derive the pure interest rate part of the client rate. But on top of that, the bank needs or can add a commercial margin for each of the instruments. So in the product template, this is what is highlighted in green. So there are a few different ways to do that. You can either define a fixed margin rate that will apply strictly and consistently to all your deals. So you can define it's a number here that you can define, and it will be applied so that your client rate will be the result of your rate determination plus the margin. And the other is the lookup. It's actually great. It gives even more flexibility. Ultimately, it's the same. Your rate will still be computed in the same way, but it's just that dynamically the margin can depend on credit rating, economic index, horizon, or maturity date. And we could also include a seasonality in there. So it's pretty nice. Okay. So I actually did manage to cover all the BSS, the balance sheet strategy, and how to define assumptions using this feature. But what I wanted to cover now is actually what I've been introducing in our solution to help you make more granular assumptions or take a step further in what you want, what are the alternative scenarios that you can build. So the first one, the first feature that I think is super relevant is the transformation on BSS targets. So we mentioned that you could define some targets, and that each set of assumptions that include the target is mapped to a scenario, and you could map different assumptions to different scenarios. But what we feel, especially in a context where, for example, in the context of IRRBB, or for example, we are comparing measure in a wide range of interest rate scenarios, we might also want to look at a shocked balance sheet growth scenario. So we felt that it would be interesting to apply to have the transformation that is available for market data supported for the balance sheet strategy too. So the idea is it's very straightforward. It's very similar to what we do with interest rate. It's a possibility to define some shifts or offsets. So here I'm just showing that I had some BSA, I had defined a BSF with some target that were 1K, 1.5K, and 1.8K. Instead of just defining another balance sheet with another target, I'm just defining a shift of 20%. And during my computation, the target will be automatically recomputed. So I think it's pretty useful. Again, the idea is always to say, ultimately, I'm defining all those assumptions in my, all those building blocks in my scenario, because ultimately I want to generate results and be able to compare, okay, what's the impact and how does it affect my different measures. And here, of course, we are talking about dynamic simulations, so we're especially looking at the NII. But anyway, that was the first one. Feature, and there is another one that was, I believe, like highly expected from a lot of our clients, is the rollover. So why did we introduce the rollover? As flexible as balance sheet strategy is, it was not always suited to define assumptions for specific portfolios, such as maybe corporate loans. Why? When deriving characteristic, like if you remember, like we just talked about the allocation set, when deriving characteristics for the new deal, we are analyzing all the stock deals and not necessarily the deals that are maturing. The idea being that the deal that had been originated in the past gives a good approximation to what type of deals are going to be originated. The idea is not that we are replacing the deals that are maturing. Another thing, the targets are defined by bucket to achieve an average on end balance. The targets are not applied across the buckets. So this approach really, again, it makes perfect sense in the context of retail and in a lot of contexts, but for rollover of a large, very large corporate loan, for example, it made more sense to have something dedicated, because replacing a very large deal at the end of a bucket rather than at its maturity date, which might be maybe 10 days later, and with like slightly different characteristic, might have an impact actually on measures. And yeah, so that's why we did introduce this rollover. So to talk to you briefly, I will walk you through the assumptions of the rollover. But in a few words, how does the rollover work? Is for each deal that is maturing, we are going to generate a new deal. So at each maturity day, we are generating a new deal. You will see when I show you the assumption, they are very much straightforward compared to the balance strategy assumption. The reason is by default, all the characteristics of those deals that are generated are the same as the one that matures. So there isn't that many assumptions. But let's look at the assumption in detail. So as I mentioned, it's only a few. It's actually the major assumption is the rollover percentage. It can vary across a horizon segment that is defined by the user. Another assumption is the rate determination method. It's actually similar to the one that I just introduced for balance strategy. The idea is to say that although all the characteristics are similar between the roll deals and the original deal, we might still want to compute a forward rate for forward fixed rate. So we are enabling that. We're also enabling the strip method that I mentioned earlier. So because there is this forward rate method that is available, I also might need to define a curve for pricing purpose and a tenor. And also very similarly to what is done for balance sheet strategy, I not only I can also define the spread on top of this interest rate that is derived using the rate determination method. This spread can be defined according to the deal size and I think the length of the deal. And finally, there is, so we, I said that all the characteristics were the same. We can still override the fixed rate value if we want to. Another thing that we can override is the maturity. Why did we give her the possibility to define the maturity? It's really a matter of, like, I mentioned that one portfolio that we might want to roll is like large corporate loans. Something else might be maybe repo that has a very short maturity. So really, do I want to generate, let's say if my observation period is 5 years and that my repo are 3 months, do I really want to generate that many repo? Or maybe I can extend a bit the maturity so I don't have to generate that many new deals. That's actually the reason we have introduced this. And that's it, actually. Yeah, as I mentioned, it's, the rollover feature is a great tool, and yeah, it was very much anticipated. It's really about generating. It's really about the like-for-like simulation. So for every deal that is maturing, I'm just going to generate a new one over a specific period of time, and the characteristics are strictly similar except for the few that can be overridden. So that's why the setup is much simpler, and the assumptions, there are way less assumptions here.